Namaskaram, Namaste. You know, so many languages and such a diverse culture. It's like I'm just blessed to be here amongst eminent speakers on the dais, eminent speakers in the audience, and just overall accomplished females who are here, each one of us in accomplished in our own way. Okay, let's open the session. It's my privilege and honor to open the session on women and education. Could I have the slideshow, please? Okay, next slide, please. Okay, let's begin with some humor. I mean, that life is important to have a little laugh. So I just, you know, conceived it in a message. So the message is, with smartphone, this is the productivity, and this is the productivity without smartphones, right? Okay, but when the speakers ask to turn off the cell phones, what happens is, can I have the next slide, please? When the speakers ask to turn off the cell phones, majority turn it off to silent, which is not turning off the cell phones. It's just, oh, nobody else can hear, right? Okay. Enough of humor, let's move to our session. Okay, so please focus on what the speakers are going to say. So, we are going to talk today about women and education. So you might wonder, let's first of all understand what is education. Well, there are two distinct definitions of education. One is systematic instruction, which is a means to earn a living and which is tangible. This is basically where you get academic degree college, like a degree from a college, or maybe a diploma, or a tradesperson like a certified plumber, certified electrician. Regardless, it's a way to earn the livelihood. That's systematic instruction. The other important definition of education and why we have gathered here today is an enlightening experience. This is something that we feel within, intangible, we cannot put a finger to it. This is about our culture, values, spirituality. And where do we learn this? We typically learn this in our formative years. As we are growing up, our parents influence us, the family, the extended family, the society. That's where we learn this. Next slide, please. So why focus on women, you might ask? Women both represent and impact the culture of a nation, as has been said so many times before. And the status of a nation is indicated by the status of its women. When we say a cultured household, we mean that each one in the household respects each other, including men respecting women and vice versa. So women influence the next generation of both females and males, be it in the household as mothers or be it as teachers. In whatever ways, women have huge influence on the next generation. So we must ensure that women are well educated in both systematic instruction and Hindu values, culture and spirituality, because they need to be financially independent as well as be able to impart these values to the next generation. So, a child may ask, are Hindu values and culture relevant to today's times? Okay, let's look. Ancient culture, recent applications. All of you heard of AI, artificial intelligence seeks to create machines that think and act like humans. Alexa, would you please remind me of the boy Hindu promise tomorrow? Okay. Programming and natural languages is an important area of AI, okay? Black is the best natural language for coding AI apps as it has minimum deviation. I want some responses from the crowd. Yeah, this is an amazing audience, Spring NASA. NASA to echo Sanskrit in space. So, you know, I mean, think about it. It is our language. NASA is adopting it. You know, so we have to think a little bit, pause. Some of the earliest written records of dhyan, or the English word is meditation, come from Hindu traditions. What does meditation do? Has many benefits like stress reduction, emotional well-being, and enhanced self-awareness. But all these benefits were actually pointed out or realized by the Western culture, and then it became popular again in part. It used to be very popular, had a decline a little bit, and then, you know, resurgence of the meditation popularity. So really it's up to us to realize the values in our culture and our heritage and actually capitalize on it and build it further. Women and education, to recap, basically it is systematic instruction and Hindu culture and values. Let's talk a little bit about Hindu Dharma. Some tenets of Hindu Dharma, it's basically a guide for righteous way of living with the ultimate goal being self-realization. There has to be unison in thoughts, words, deeds, and input and mind, intellect. You know, basically that unison is important. What we think is exactly what we should say and act like. That's what Hinduism means. One's duties, rights, laws in family and society, the biggest part of Hinduism, there is no single authority. There are multiple paths to moksha. There is jnana yoga, there is bhakti yoga, there is karma yoga. So, and there is no single authority that we can point to that defines Hinduism. Okay, leaving here without an action plan would be something like, hey, we have talked so much, so what's the outcome? Okay, so this is about the outcome for the action plan. I would like the initiative, I would suggest that if it takes a little bit of money, that be invested by the government or corporate social responsibility grants that are so popular. And Sumantrite Suvigrante. So let's have a committee that creates an action plan and provides continuous oversight. We need to define the goals and strategies. We need some curriculum by age groups. Can I have a slide here? Hello? Okay. The same content may be taught in different languages to preserve regional cultures and promote the unity in our rich diversity. So important that we don't lose our languages. And it is common that the languages can be dying out because there's so much insistence on English being taught in schools, and it is our responsibility going forward to make sure we preserve our languages and the culture. And train the trainer. There is no reason for us to assume that suddenly mothers would know what to teach the children, and they may be relating stories, but really we need to have some classes, like some actual training for the mothers, for the teachers, to actually know what they should be teaching. And this could be implemented either formally or informally. It doesn't matter. And that's for the committee to decide. And then we assess results, evaluate and align strategies, and the process continues. But we need something like that so that when we meet again in 2022, we would be talking about, hey, what did we achieve in the 4 years that for women in education. But before we do that, the speakers here are going to enlighten us about what are some aspects about women and education that we should be focusing on. So let's go to our speaker list here. The first speaker, I invite Dr. Nivedita Bhide, who is going to talk about the responsibility of Hindu women as Hindu ambassadors. And okay, let me read her bio. Padma Shri Nivedita Bhide, Raghunath Bhide, is the Vice President of Vivekananda Kendra, Kanyakumari. She has been a full-time worker since 1977, She is in charge of training of life workers and teachers of the Kendra and is a regular faculty in yoga camps. She has written over 15 books and presented papers in many seminars and was a member of National Council for Teacher Education. She has guided 17 seminars on the Janajatis of Northeast Bharat. She is recipient of Padma Shri from Government of Bharat for social service, and she received an honorary doctorate from Desh Bhagat University, Punjab in 2017. Let's welcome Padma Shri, Dr. Nivedita.
Chandrika Tandon, she was telling, she had everything, And yet, you know, she was feeling unhappy. Only when she realized Aham Brahmasmi, it is that. That is the journey towards which I have to go. Then only some satisfaction came in life. So the aim of life is manifestation of divinity by controlling the nature, external and internal. That's how Swami Vivekananda says. Then reverence to all. Because we say it is one which has become many. Ishvara is everywhere. So reverence for everything. It is nature, environment, animals, plants, our elders, women, highest respect for women we see the as value only in our dharma. That is only in Hindu dharma the God can be worshipped as Jagadishwari also. He may be Jagadishwar or he may be also Jagadishwari. Then it is not there are diversities and we try to find out the connecting principle as today morning Mananiya Mohanji was telling. But it is the underlying unity of what has expressed as diverse things. That is one which has expressed as many. So when we look at the many, we try to see the underlying unity and that is why we cherish the diversity. We don't go for uniformity. We don't say only I am true and others are false. And that is why in Hindu Dharma there is space for everyone. And very important, the life of restraint. So as to contribute harmony at all levels, at my individual life, family life, social life, national life, and also for the whole humanity. Now coming to this, if we want to inculcate this vision and values, or if the women have to be Hindu ambassadors, you know, it has to be three-pronged approach. That is jnana level, bhakti level and karma level. Jnana is, I know what is Hindu dharma, I know many things and fortunately many of us sitting here we know. The second is the pride and intense love for my dharma, for the tradition in which I am born. And also pride, proud to be a woman because a woman has a specific role as a mother which, you know, only she can fulfill. Even when the child is in the womb, she can start giving those samskaras to the child. And third is the karma, that is the practice of dharma through cultural forms, traditions, customs and rituals. Now here the question comes, that is knowledge and love not enough? We see many Hindus like that. They know much about Hindu dharma, they have read Bhagavad Gita and all that. And they also are very proud Hindus. But you know that alone is not enough. What is required is transmitting of these vision and values if I have to be ambassador. So this is something which I would like to slightly explain upon this. So if we don't go for practices, then we will be only professing Hindus and not practicing Hindus. And professing Hindu can never become the ambassador of Hindu Dharma. This is what I would like to make a very humble submission. And that is what today is the problem of Hindu society. We should be assertive, we should be practicing Hindus. Because the vision and values are abstract. So abstract things cannot be transmitted to the next generation. For that very beautiful example given by Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa, that is the Guru of Swami Vivekananda is, you know, we eat rice. But to have rice from one harvest to second harvest, we don't bow rice, we bow paddy. Isn't it? If someone says that, oh, we only eat rice, why to bow paddy? Let us bow directly rice, we will get directly rice. But that's not so. We don't eat husk and yet we need the husk to transmit the rice from one harvest to the next harvest. So same way, to transmit the vision and values of Hindu Dharma from one generation to the next generation, we need certain cultural practices in our family regularly. We cannot say that we will do away with the cultural practices. Why we should do this? Why we should worship a river? Why we should do namaskar to the elders in the family? why we should have certain puja in the house, why certain things should be done in family, certain family rituals are there. You know, nowadays we question that. Is it not enough that I know what Hindu Dharma is, I know Bhagavad Gita, and I am also proud of it? No, it's not enough. Because for inculcating and for radiating it, certain practices are needed. Again, I will give you one small example. You know, in many of our Hindu houses, suppose there is the birthday of a child, 4-year-old, you know, he is put on new clothes and he is told, you go and do namaskar to God and then Bhagavan ko namaskar karke aao, we tell. The child does not ask the question, which God should I go and do namaskar? You know, in puja room there is Tirupati Balaji, Kanyakumari, Durga Devi, Ramakrishna, and so many photos are there. The child does not ask, which God should I pray? He goes there, he does not do a separate namaskar to each one. He does one namaskar and comes back. Now, this 4-year-old child, how does he know that though there are many names and forms of God, God is only one? The fact to know which many other non-Hindu thinkers struggle, you know, to understand this. How a 4-year-old knows? Because he sees his mother doing namaskar to the elders. She says, we shall go to Bhagwan ka darshan karne jayenge, we shall go to pray to God. Then on the way she will do namaskar to the step of the temple. Then she will do namaskar to the Nandi. Then she will do namaskar to Ganesh, to Shiva. But she doesn't say, Bhagwanon ka namaskar karne jayenge. Aisa nahi kehti hai. She does not say, we will go to see gods. She says, we will go to have darshan of God. So, it is through such practices, such a great truth is internalized by the child. And therefore, these cultural practices are very important. If that we live from our life, it will be very difficult to transmit this vision of oneness from one generation to the next generation. So, this is one thing. If we want to be ambassador, there have to be certain practices which we have to do. You know, great realized souls also, they do certain regular sadhana. Why do they do? It is only to transmit that, you know, to radiate that fact that in order to transmit it to the next generation, each one of us has to be practicing. I may not need it and yet I have to practice it. So many of our Hindu homes are losing the practices. That's why this point I am stressing more. Now coming just to the last few points, you know, that is already spoken in the morning, that you know, now the challenge is, we have forgotten that in Hindu Dharma, the aspirations of life are fourfold. Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha. Everything should be based on Dharma. So Artha, but now if we are giving importance only to Artha and Kama, then that is what the problem comes, and that's what we are seeing. The problem is there. So, but women have slightly better benefits because their heart is more sensitive, they feel for the family, for the children, and therefore they are better equipped to be Hindu ambassadors. Secondly, it's not only that we are radiating our Hindu Dharma, you know, we are also aiding in human evolution further. Unless this vision of oneness and these values are transmitted to the humanity, the further evolution of human being will not take place. And if we see any problem in the world, and if we analyze it, you know, the problem is that man there in that problem, his consciousness was not evolved. So what actually we need is to further evolve the consciousness of human being. And that is where Hindu Dharma has to play a big role. So when I become the ambassador of Hindu Dharma, I am actually helping the whole humanity to evolve. And coming to the last point, and my time is already up. last point is that all of us, we are sitting here, we are all accomplished women. So somewhere, and I was very happy, many of you have done also, that if we acknowledge today whatever I am is because of the samskaras done by my parents, and that is how we establish the importance of samskaras in the minds of the younger generation, the future generation, I think somewhere we will be rooted to the ground only through practices. We practice and that's how we internalize the vision and values, and that's how we radiate it to the whole humanity. So that's where I end. Thank you.
That was beautiful, Dr. Bhide, how you talked about the three-pronged approach of jnana, karma and bhakti for the women to, you know, inculcate values and that culture into our next generation. To carry the torch forward, let me invite Dr. Meena Chandawarkar. Let me read a short bio for her. Dr. Meena Chandawarkar is the chief advisor for BDD Sangha, a leading group of over 153 educational institutions. She was the former vice chancellor, Karnataka State Women's University. She has served on national and state level on behalf of the HRD Ministry, Government of Bharat, and many other prestigious boards. She has written books related to quality circles and HRD and participated in many conferences. She has also been actively involved in social outreach activities. She is a recipient of over 15 awards, including Best Teacher in Commerce from the Government of Karnataka. Congratulations for the award.
शिवे सर्वार्थ साधिके चरणे त्र्यंबके गौरी नारायणी नमोस्तुते. Today is the auspicious day of Friday, and that also the last Friday of the auspicious month of Shravan. For those in USA, perhaps they are not aware of it, but we from Bharat, yes, we are fasting. We appreciate, and I offer my pranams and namaskars to the Daivi Shakti in all, both ladies and gentlemen present here. Namaskar to everyone. It's my privilege to participate in this historical conference, coming all the way from Bharat. Imagine the happiness we feel, which I think words cannot express, to be in a place where Swami Vivekananda himself had addressed everyone as brothers and sisters, thereby conveying a very important Hindu value of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. That means the entire world is a family. It's not important which country you belong to, but the entire humanity, it is a family. And that is what made his speech, his talk at Chicago, an historical one. And we are here today to participate, to commemorate 125 years of that historical speech. My topic, the title is a bit long, but I am sure I'll share my views keeping in mind the time constraints which are offered to me. The next one, next slide. I would like to share my views very briefly to analyze the inspiring contribution made by Hindu women over the ages, and link it to the higher education scenario today, because this session is on women and education, and to convey a very important message, how influential or how important our role is as women, because Bharat has now come ahead in the field of education across the globe. What is the Hindu woman's role in this context, and how can we blend our Sattvic Hindu values in the curriculum through a policy changes for peace and harmony in the world. Most importantly, as many of the speakers have already pointed out, the mother is the first teacher and she is the guru of the child. So no matter how busy we are, do we find time to be the ideal guru for our child is something which we really need to think about. Of all the religions, next one please. It would be no exaggeration to say that of all the global religions, women have the most respectable, visible and prominent presence in the Hindu Dharma. It is the only major religion which worships God also as a woman, and all other major faiths, they see God as a fatherly figure. The Rig Veda has correctly quoted, the home has verily its foundation in the wife, who is termed as, who is looked upon as a Shakti Swarupini. The goddess Kali symbolizes restrictive energy, destructive energy. Goddess Durga, protective energy. Lakshmi, the nourishing energy. And Saraswati, the creative energy. Of the 407 sages of the Vedic times, 21 were women who contributed to writing hymns. Gargi and Maitreyi were some of them. Then after the Vedic times, until 500 BCE, women were denied education and religious parity. But we still have examples of a long and illustrious life of 800 years of the Nalanda University from the 5th to the 12th centuries. And now, 800 years after its destruction, in 2014, another Nalanda University has been set up in Bharat, in the state of Bihar, headed by a woman vice chancellor. It is a center, an international center for research and learning, and it is headed, the first vice chancellor is a woman. Actually, it's very rare, because hardly 3-4% across the state of Bharat, across the country of Bharat, 3-4% of the university chancellors are women. But then this university, the first, has the privilege of the first vice chancellor being a woman. And then in the 12th century, I have to go a bit fast because of time constraints. The 12th century saw the Anubhav Mantapa, which was set up by Lord Basveshwara. It was the fountain head of religious philosophy and thought, and it is known as the first parliament in the world. And Akka Mahadevi was one of the most creative poets who took part in the scholarly and the learned discussions in the Anubhav Mantap. The 13th to 14th centuries saw women saints like Muktabai, Janabai of Maharashtra, and Laleshwari of Kashmir, and so on. And then the 16th to 19th centuries, we saw women warriors, Lakshmi Bai of Jhansi, Kittu Rani Channamma, and many more philanthropists like Rani Rashmoni Devi, who contributed for education. Hindu spiritual texts were written by women. We saw freedom fighters, social reformers like Vandaniya Lakshmi Bai Kelkar, who established the Rashtra Sevika Sangh in 1936. And we also have seen many priests and scholars, women priests and scholars during this period. And then after the 19th century, after 20th century, Pandita Ramabai Saraswati, she was a great pioneer in education. The first women's university was established in 1916 by a Hindu, Shri Dondo Keshav Tarve in Pune, in Mumbai. And it has a branch in Pune to the SNDT University. The first woman to have passed in Western medicine, Dr. Anandibai Gopal Joshi in 1836. And of course, the first woman graduate of Bharat, Kadambini Ganguly and Chandramukhi Basu. So we have a number of examples of such women who have been great inspiration for womanhood here. And I must mention the name of just two more. Nirupama Rao, the first ever foreign secretary for Bharat, who played a very, very critical role in strengthening the relations between Bharat and America, and the United States of America. And of course, Kalpana Chawla, who is one of the most remembered Bharatiya American astronaut. And the list goes on. Now it is endless. The list goes on. But then, why the next slide, please? Why I'm correlating this with education is that we should understand the prominent position which Bharat has today. It is the regional hub for higher education, attracting global learners from all over the world. Not only its enrollment numbers have dramatically enhanced, but also the learning outcomes in terms of skills, in terms of innovation, in terms of entrepreneurship, and so on. It is the single largest provider of global talent. 1 in 4 graduates in the world is from the Bharat system of education. At least 100 of our universities compete with the global best in research excellence framework. And Bharat has emerged to be the 3rd in purchasing power parity and 6th in dollar term in the world economy due to her rich demographic dividend, that is the youth power. Can't we be, are we justified in saying this youth power, this youngistan can definitely make a better and a more productive Hindustan? It is this youngistan which can make a better and a more productive Hindustan. Next slide, please. Hence, the immense to create an impact it is really great. There are many points here. The most important one I would like to point is, by 2025, the number of students in higher education is expected to reach 263 million around the world. And our MOOCs program, the massive open online courses program, they enroll 60% of the world's entire student population. Wow. Imagine controlling 60% of the world's entire population. That means you can get an idea of what is the impact. If we make up our mind, it is a small step now, but in future, it will definitely have a great impact. Next slide, please. So blending Hindu values through our policy, it is of great importance. Our Hindu Dharma, Hindu symbolizes eternal, and Dharma symbolizes which sustains everything. That which sustains everything permanently, that is nothing but a way of life and the Hindu Dharma. And Hindu samskars, including education, cultivation of values and practice, thereby enrichment of life, is definitely the main end, the purpose of higher education. So prayer, meditation and yoga, together with satya, ahimsa, daya and dana, all these values, which are of course Hindu values, but they are also universal values. Everyone likes prayer, everyone seeks the blessings of God, everyone believes in charity, everyone has these values, which is nothing which is professed and practiced by all Hindus. Sarve janaha sukhino bhavantu, not only for Bharat, but all the living creatures, as Nivedita ji said, not only human beings, but also birds and beasts and animals and so on. So these sattvic values can be made universal by choice. The next one, please. So the woman's role in an age where youth is fast succumbing to flimsy attractions of Western culture, as is evident from modes of living, from the eating habits, from the social behavior, not in all cases, but in general, I'm talking, it is a very important matter which causes for a lot of discussion and a lot of thought today, that the woman has to be the first guru of her child. And she, unless she herself is wedded to such good habits and culture, she cannot transfer it to her children. So it is not only professing, not only preaching, but also practicing. And when she practices, she will be really making it just one more, half a minute more, man. So here I would like to I would like to emphasize the importance of prayer, which the mother, you know, she transfers to her child. When the child says not gods but God, the mother convinces the child that with him there is an endless hope, but without him there is a hopeless end. And that is the power of the prayer. That is the power of the prayer. So let us be guided by all these great women across the centuries, right from the Vedic times. Let us be guided by the spirit of commitment, by the sincerity and sacrifice, without which we will never be able to reduce at least a fraction of the three worst evils of mankind. One is corruption, second one is violence on women, and third one is ensuring genuine care of elders. We say Matru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava. But why are our parents in old age homes today then? What about our culture then today? So when we do it, naturally our children will follow it. So there has to be a solution to this problem, which we have to. I'm speaking out of experience. I've had the rare privilege of looking after my parents and my parents-in-law. All the four of them, they were with me. And when I was the Vice Chancellor of the university, imagine my happiness when I saw the three of them who were remaining at that time. They were sitting in the first row, and I sought their blessings and then went ahead with the convocation. So I think this is something which has to be experienced by each one of us. The last slide. So the way ahead is to transfer these samskars from ourselves to the next generation, not only the next generation, the generations to come. And for these two examples I have mentioned here, one is of UGC, in which I have the opportunity of chairing the Standing Committee for Women's Studies, which the UGC has. And we in the committee, Standing Committee, we have ensured that there are 159 women's study centers across Bharat. And for all the women's study centers, we have changed the curriculum in such a way that there is in the Bharat's perspective, we have taken the curriculum in such a manner that all these values are included in that, from the perspective of Bharat. So how a policy change can matter, that is what I want to explain. Secondly, in my university, the Karnataka State Women's University, I set up a center for ideal womanhood. The name of the center was Center for Ideal Womanhood. There was no exam or no grade related to that, the courses which it offered. But it focused on four important aspects. One is meditation, the spirituality. One is a strong character building. Third is a civic sense. And fourth is the concern for elders. And so why I wanted to share this is, if we have the power, if we have the opportunity, we should implement it as a matter of policy and see that it is implemented. And this vision may seem too ambitious, but it can be a reality in future. A future we stand to forfeit if we don't act now. And we means we all together. And that is the theme of this conference. Sumantrite and Subikrante. All of us, we have to think collectively and we have to achieve valiantly. And never forgetting that we are gigantic in potential. We women are gigantic in potential. Then why accept to be Lilliputian in reality? Why be Lilliputian?
That was very beautiful, Meena ji. Beautiful illustrious history that you will do of our women from the past, the present, and then guided us for the future. That is amazing. And something I noted was that she is one of the top 3 or 4%, because she has served as a vice chancellor. So that is something to acknowledge. Shravan Shukrabar, she mentioned it, and just like Dr. Bhide had said before, we need to practice our samskars, and by practicing is how we are going to transmit them to the next generation. Something you might not remember, but I did it on purpose, is on my title slide. I didn't call myself just Anuradha Gokhale. I also said Anjali Pindsik. Because that's where I got my samskars from, my parents. So, and my maiden family. And so it's important for all of us women to remember our maiden homes. So, thank you. And let me invite the third evidence speaker, who is here from Guyana, all the way from Guyana, and Dr. Vindhya Vasini Persaud. Let me read a short bio for her. Dr. Vindhya Vasini Persaud is a member of parliament and president of the Guyana Hindu Dharmic Sabha. You will have many opportunities to applaud for them. Every sentence there is a huge accomplishment. She is a physician and has taught at the University of Guyana School of Medicine and currently hosts TV and radio programs. A trained Kathak dancer, she is a director and choreographer of Naya Zamana, an award-winning theatrical dance production. She has developed initiatives to improve the welfare of underprivileged women, youth and children. She has won number of awards including Medal of Service from Guyana and the Pranav Ashram Award in Canada for her work in religion and service to humanity.
Thank you very much. Brothers and sisters all, Namaskar, Namaste, Sitaram, Sadar Pranam. And if you responded like that, it relates directly to my topic, making sure that we have an identity in a multicultural world. That is a spontaneous greeting that would have been taught to us by our parents. And when we fold our hands and we bow reverently and we utter those simple words, we recognize the divinity in all. And right away, that defines us as Hindus. Right away, that identifies where we belong, where we come from. Of course, it is indeed a pleasure, an honor, and I'm very humbled to be among indefatigable, indomitable, tireless Hindus from across the world who contribute in so many ways to their country, their community, and to Sanatana Vedic Dharma, the comprehensive way of life that we all follow. I salute you, I pay tribute to you. When we speak of identity, we all define ourselves in so many different ways. But when we are fortunate to be born in a Hindu home, or later on to follow the Hindu life, if you're not born as such, I think it is indeed a privilege because we subscribe to that way of life that is inclusive. That is so inclusive that it recognizes that there are so many paths to that one supreme. It gives us the opportunity to have our personal spiritual journey. It gives us the rare opportunity to share ideas and perspectives as vast as the library of scriptures that we have at our disposal as Hindus. My history, perhaps, is similar or not so similar to many of you. I come from Guyana in South America, geographically. We're also part of the Caribbean. And this country has a history of indentureship. In 1838, men and women from India, Bharat, as you refer to India today, men and women came to work on the sugar plantations. They were looking for a life of betterment. They did not know the hardship, the vicissitudes, and the challenges they were to face in a land so far away from home. Right there, they could have lost their identity, because the hardships were terrible. Their lives were lost. They had few possessions. They lost many of their siblings, their families. They were separated. And you think that would crush their spirit. But what kept them going? Maybe it was the little books that they carried with them. And you know what that little book was? Ramayana. So that's why if you come to Guyana and you're greeted with Sitaram, you know you're in Guyana. Women have inherent power, if unleashed, to transform any environment in which they find themselves. Today, as I listened to my sisters presenting, I said, yes, power is being unleashed today. And I'm sure more of it will be gushing forth in the days to come. So when we look at our identity, and we look at our customs, our samskars, do not hesitate to have your children grow up understanding and being a part of that. A simple thing, how you dress, how you conduct yourself out there, those things, without you seeing anything, should be able to tell the world that you're of Hindu origin, because you should wear your garments with pride. The way in which you interface, engage, interact with those persons out there whom you come into contact with, your principles of honor, integrity, holding or adhering to your word, and being people who are fearless in your stance, should tell people you're Hindu. After all, we have so many powerful, powerful icons to follow. Whether we speak of God as Shakta or Shakti, or we speak of the living legends who were our predecessors, we have those. In their footsteps, we march behind. It's their shoes we try to fill. So I can tell you a story, a tiny one. When I was in the university, I remember going there, and everyone there, a good percentage of the population were Hindus. So I thought, well, we're observing Janmashtami. Why don't we have a puja? We did. But I was the only one in the entire campus who decided to wear an Indian garment. Only one. The next year, there were five people. Now, for everyone, everybody, and it's not only Hindus, wearing an Indian garment. When I graduated, I wore a sari. It has become commonplace. But it just takes the first tiny step of you saying, I am who I am, and being unapologetic about it, because it does not detract from you being a servant of your people, in my instance, being Guyanese, and being very, very happy to serve, or being the president of the Guyana Hindu Dharmic Sabha, and serving under that beautiful Gita line, Karmaneva Dhikaraste Mahaleshi Kadachana, action thy duty, reward not thy concern. And then we can go on beyond those simple things. How are you perceived by the wider world? It is how you express yourself. You have to be willing to educate people on who you are and what you stand. Don't assume that they understand you. We are a misunderstood population. And because we are misunderstood, young people have to face ridicule, they are ashamed to be who they are, and sometimes we hide behind what people do not understand. So educate, explain. So you must have patience, you must have perseverance, and you must not only stop at people being tolerant of you, you must work on there being mutual respect. That's having identity in a multicultural world. My country of Ghana, because we've had so many people, we call it the land of six people, and that comes with a melting pot of cultures. But you know what? I can hold Guyana proudly to say, whether you're Hindu, whether you're Christian, whether you're Muslim, whether you're Baha'i, we all live harmoniously, because we have worked, and many have worked before us, to develop that thing called mutual respect. And it is something that we must continue to foster. And we can only foster it if, as Hindus, we speak with one voice. If, as Hindus, we stand united. And if, as women, we always, always make sure we stand up for our sisters out there. Don't leave it for anyone else to do. Stand up for the sister that you have out there. So I want to say, as we build on our identity in a multicultural society, as we work on building our visibility in the rest of the world, and we are trending in so many ways. Maybe what comes from our culture and our religion, it's repackaged and given so many different names. Just look at yoga. There are all kinds of things, but it's still yoga. So don't let it be repackaged, and don't let people know where it came from. It came from what we were lucky to call our heritage and our legacy. And we have a responsibility to pass that torch on to the next generation. So to all the women out there, Swami Vivekananda said beautifully, you can educate a man, you educate one man, you educate a woman, and you educate the world. Potential educators and those who are continuing to educate, I want to say this. Don't only let us say Matri Deva Bhava. Let us epitomize what it is to teach our children the right thing. Let us transmit the message in such a way that it appeals to this generation and generation next in language that they understand, simple language, language that they relate to, so they will be unashamed, unafraid to stand up and be identified and counted in the multicultural world that we live in. Once again, brothers and sisters, I thank you. It is an extreme pleasure to share these thoughts with you. I hope I've not overstepped my time. You know, when you're in Parliament, the speaker has to say, okay, you have 5 minutes. Okay, you have 5 minutes. And you know what politicians do, they keep talking. But thank you so much, and it's time to take my responsibility.
Very beautiful, Vindhya ji. That story, she related this fact to a story that we need to maintain our identities. Isn't it beautiful that when our Hindus went to Guyana, they were able to maintain our culture even today after hundreds of years? Because of our strong values and the samskars and maintaining them and passing them on. So that's so important. In the interest of samay, I'm told that we won't have a Q&A for this session, so we will have to conclude. But let us keep the conversation going. That's why we are here, to connect with each other. So let's thank again the entire